grant a few chances, you know, to say hello to each other. So, but I shall we just go ahead and start? Because we'll wish we will have used these minutes.
Later sure. On.
Yeah. So I think we're starting with Penny. The team that works on these are John Robinson. John, wave your hand. Yes. And myself, I'm Gail Ransom. And then Penny Andrews, waving her hand. Yeah. And so we're happy for help. We're sticking with this climate crisis once a month and working on getting our energy and wisdom focused. So we'd be glad to have some help if anybody wants to help us and feel so moved, let us know. Okay.
I had the good fortune to be at Matt's presentation at Siena Center in Racine. And I thought I'd open with the first verse of a poem he shared there. At the River Clarion by Mary Oliver. And I invite you just to close your eyes or just focus on your breath and let Mary Oliver's words in, a great mystic of our times. I don't know who God is exactly, but I'll tell you this. I was sitting in the river named Clarion on a water-splashed stone. And all afternoon I listened to the voices of the river talking. Whenever the water struck a stone, it had something to say. And the water itself, and even the mosses trailing under the water. And slowly, very slowly, it became clear to me what they were saying. Said the river, I am part of holiness. And I too, said the stone. And I too whispered the moss beneath the water. I'd been to the river before a few times. Don't blame the river that nothing happened quickly. You don't hear such voices in an hour or a day. You don't hear them at all if selfhood has stuffed your ears. And it's difficult to hear anything anyway through all the traffic, the ambition. John?
Penny. And now from John, who's unmute. I'm going to unmute you, John.
Oh, my. Oh, I'll start over again.
Okay.
So anyway, welcome to Creation in Crisis, a conversation with Matthew Fox. It is our great, great pleasure to have Matt with us again today. Though he needs no introduction, we should remind our audience that Matt is the founder and ongoing inspiration of Creation Spirituality Theology and Creation Spirituality Communities. His many decades of teaching blends the wisdom of indigenous, Eastern, and Western spiritualities with the revelations of modern science to revitalize our culture and pedagogy, promote social and ecological justice, and awaken an engaged mysticism. An incredibly prolific writer, Matt is the author of at least 37 books and counting on creation spirituality and is nearly a constant speaker on the most important political, ecological, and spiritual issues of our time. Today, Matt will be addressing the rapidly escalating climate apocalypse, the most pressing existential crisis humanity has ever faced. In his online series, Daily Meditations, he has been reaching out to all social and environmental activists, mystic explorers, justice makers, cosmic thinkers, and earth keepers to respond to the urgent call of creation. In today's conversation, we hope to ignite the passions of all these activist types in an enlightened response to the climate catastrophe. And I pass the baton back to Gail to welcome our audience and preview our program.
Hey. Welcome all of you. And I have the names of you if you are calling in by phone, but not on your screens as I expected. But we can work with this. And what we want to do is spend the first time listening and then give some time for questions and answers afterwards. But let me walk you through the screen a little bit. If you go down to the bottom of the page with however you do that, with your finger or your mouse, Then you see at the bottom, you have a tray that shows up, right? And so you have a chance there to put yourself on mute. So what we're going to do is, actually, I'll do it for you. For the first 45 minutes, we're going to all be on mute except for Matt and each one of us when we're interviewing him. And then after that, we'll open them up and open up the microphones and see where the conversation goes. Then Penny will close it. So our plan is that that first section will be 45 minutes, 15 minutes each under the leadership of each one of us, and then another 30 minutes for questions and answers, which we think will be a nice bit of time. If things go in a different direction, we'll follow because we're creation spirituality. So we like it when we're being led by spirit and creativity. So for introductions, I would like to invite you to just say your name, where you are from, so we're talking about two words there, and then something, just the name of it, what you find in your region that you consider and experience as sacred. So I have a list here. I'm gonna start on the list. So I'm just gonna call your name because that's the best way to do it. Okay. Who has the number 360-393-0003? Okay, Annie Areo. Okay. I'm gonna.
I don't hear anyone.
We lost Gail.
Gail, you're muted. Oh, there you go.
I went totally to another universe and I just apologize. Okay, so
life on the frontier.
Yeah, so we'll try this again. Okay.
Mystics
in motion.
And then is unmuted. And John, actually, you're now at the top of the list. John Robinson.
Oh, okay. I'm John Robinson. I live on Fox Island in the Puget Sound. And what's sacred to me is the land, is where the water touches the shore, all around us here. It's just magic.
Lynn Richards? Edwards?
Hi, yeah, I'm in Aiken, South Carolina, and I'm thinking that these seven rescue dogs sitting in this room with me are sacred, although they've been a little bit rowdy.
Thank you. Barbara? Nash. Barbara Nash.
Barbara Nash here. I live in Maryland. I live in a retirement community. I'm on the fifth floor and I face east. And the morning sunrise
is
what I cherish.
Thank you. Okay, Annie Manuel. Anita Manuel. Sorry, it's very blurry here. Anita
Manuel in Abingdon, Virginia, and I would say the little woods next door I see from my window here.
Okay. Vicki.
Vicki Kaminer from Portsmouth, Virginia, looking out at the birds feeding at a bird feeding system that I set up outside my breakfast window every day. Thank you.
Thank you. Annalia Arau.
I am in Chicago.
Mm-hmm. Well, what's sacred in Chicago?
Everything.
Okay.
The air, the wind, you know, flowers, people.
And Carla Peterson. Carla? Okay. If you find, look for your mute button. No. Oh, here you are. She is muted. I can do it for you. Carla, tell us about yourself.
Carla Peterson, Verona, Wisconsin. And what's a sacred place for me is in the UW Arboretum, this what I call the sacred spring.
And how about Art Mitchell?
Yeah, hi. I am formerly from Fairfax, Virginia, and now I live on the western edge of Tucson, Arizona, on stolen and occupied lands of the Tohono O'odham. What I find sacred is all of the Sonoran Desert, where I happily live now.
And Connie Zwick?
Hi, everyone. You know, I'm sitting here among very old oaks, but when I was asked that question, what came to mind is my grandkids. Hmm. So I have to say, all of creation.
Thank you. I am actually in Boston using my daughter's Mac instead of my own computer. So, who else have we? Mark, we haven't heard from you yet.
Yeah, Mark Steiner here in Louisville, Kentucky. Among the sacred for me right now are the deer that occasionally sleep in my backyard.
Thank you. Okay. Have I missed anybody? Oh, I know. My friend. Okay, so yes, ma'am, who are you in yellow? Who have we missed? Anybody else? Just please go ahead.
This is Jerry in Houston. Mm-hmm. The sun and blue sky are sacred to me.
Okay. And we had another hand up.
This is Darlene Van Dyke in Blowing Rock, North Carolina. Can you hear me?
Yes, we can.
Okay. What's particularly sacred this time of year is the brilliance of the color of the leaves as they change, and especially when the sun shines through them.
Beautiful. And how about you, Janice?
Hi, I'm Janice. I'm from the UK, Gloucestershire in England.
Wonderful.
And I have a lovely oak tree I can see from my bedroom, which I find very comforting.
And Marianne.
Yes, hello, I'm Marianne Schleinick and I'm in Calgary, Alberta. And it's all white and it's snowing. And there's a couple huge trees and I love to see the squirrels and the birds play and find shelter and a spot to sit out of the wind in the trees.
Thomas?
Okay, I'm from Michigan and I have a willow tree that I watch change and do magical things.
And I'm from Pittsburgh, Pennsylvania, where we have the Three Rivers. It's the land of the Lakota. And I'm now in Boston, Massachusetts with my daughter and my granddaughter, who is definitely part of the sacred flow of life. So I think we have welcomed everyone in. Have I missed anyone?
Rolla Lewis, Portland, Oregon. Mm-hmm. I live 50 yards from Forest Park, the largest urban park in the United States, and get to watch it change the season. So, absolutely love it.
Wonderful. And Nathan, I'm not sure we got you.
Sorry, I just hit the mute button after you unmuted it. This is Nathan DeMay. I'm in Atlanta. And for me, what's sacred right now is the fact that fall is finally here and it's cooling off.
Thank you. And Mary Pat, I'm going to unmute you, Mary Pat.
Forest in Austin, Texas. And I have a
a beautiful 110-pound German Shepherd that gives me great joy.
And Carla, bless joy has for her own face. Carla, I'm going to unmute you. Okay, now, tell us.
I introduced myself before, Carla Peterson, Verona, Wisconsin. My sacred place is, for me, is at the University of Wisconsin Arboretum. There's a spring there that is really sacred.
Thank you. I see the only one we might have missed is somebody who's called in from a 360 number on the phone. I'm going to unmute you. Okay.
Hi, this is Nicola Hoffman calling from Bellingham, Washington area, and nature is sacred to me. Thank you.
Thank you. Welcome. So, welcome you all and your sacred hearts and your sensibilities. Recognize it. Penny Andrews.
I just want to acknowledge that I live on a drumlin, which is a leftover vestige of the glacier. And what it left behind is some of the richest soil in the country. And that is sacred.
Okay, John.
Okay, then. Let's get started. It's time for Matthew Fox. We've been all been waiting for this for a long time, and we've been following your daily meditations well every day. And I just so appreciate how you talk about the four paths and how we get into this whole nightmare of the climate apocalypse. So I would begin with this question. How do you view the climate crisis? Why is it here and what does it mean? I think he's muted.
There you go. I think it's here in great part because the modern era cut us off from our relationships with the whole and with other creatures. And we got so enthused in the 16th century Renaissance and what followed by our own brilliance as a species, that we became both rapacious and violent. And I think that even the successes of the Enlightenment, such as transportation and industry and modern medicine and so forth, it increased human population. We extended our life times, and so it's a mixed bag, of course, because humans have so taken over the planet that we're and yet we still carry the mindset of the modern consciousness that is so anthropocentric, or in Pope Francis's word, well chosen, narcissistic as a species, that the minds have not caught up with the pain that we have delivered to the earth, to his creatures and so forth. Now, I think the crisis win is exactly that. It is a spiritual crisis because, well, the very question you've led with, because the sacred has been ignored in so many ways. Just take education, for example. Do lawyers, do bankers, do judges, do politicians, do teachers even, do they pass through anything? Do therapists pass through anything in their training that brings up the concept of the sacred? We've so divorced education, we've so from the universe and the sacredness of the universe that we've narrow it to how to get a good job in a man-made system. So, I mean, there are just so many factors. The beating up of the feminine, and with it wisdom, and with it cosmology, the cosmos, the sense of the whole, and the ways that we can tame our reptilian brains, such as meditation, but other ways too, so that the reptilian brain doesn't run away with everything, which is what's been happening for a couple of centuries, and it's what we reward people for. So, and then a religion has become so divorced from science, and therefore psyche from cosmos, that has been so often either something trivial or something that contributes to the reptilian brain. My religion would beat up your religion and all the rest. So it serves empire instead of serving the sacred. Now, I think all these things and others, you know, it's like juggling balls. They're all in the air today, though, because I think that the time we're living in, as you say, the climate emergency really is a word that was just used, I saw this morning, in a new scientific study. They want to change the word from climate change to climate emergency. But I do think, and this addresses your second question, that the emergency is the meaning. Because when humans are faced with extinction, which we are, when we're faced with real crisis, our better selves sometimes come alive. They say necessity is the mother of invention. So I think that our better selves, and that would include interfaith or deep ecumenism, linking up with wisdom traditions, not shouting that mine is the only one or that yours is stupid. Mm-hmm. That movement is so important. And then the linking up of science and spirituality again. And I'll tell you a funny story that happened to me this past month in Spokane, Washington. I was doing some talks, and Sunday morning I gave two sermons at the Unitarian Universalist Church in Spokane. And the pastor there introduced me in the first one and said that this pulpit and this church was founded, the original pulpit, man who stood here, was a friend of John Brown and supported him. So he fled to Spokane in 1880 or something because he had a sentence over his head. They wanted to kill him because he was John Brown's ally. And I thought it was really neat. And they asked me to talk about my new book, Naming the Unnameable, 89 Wonderful and Useful Names for God. And so, because I was in a UU church while I was going around, they gave me 25 minutes, which of course doesn't happen usually in churches. I said, now, I'm sure there's some atheists out here because this is a UU church, but I just want to tell you atheists, I said, don't be a stupid atheist. Be a smart atheist. Don't attack a 17th century God, an 18th century God, a 19th century version of God. Be a smart atheist and take on a 21st century version of God. So that was just a little part of my talk. Well, then the service was over, and I was between services, I was signing books, and this guy comes up and he says, I came to church an atheist this morning, but because of your talk, I'm no longer an atheist. I said, what? You dropped your atheism after 20 minutes? I said, you must not have been a very fervent atheist. Well, he said, I was a stupid atheist, the kind you were talking about. He said, I've been attacking an 18th century God. So I'm not an atheist anymore. So anyway, I thought that was kind of fun. And I think it's kind of a sign of the times we're living in, that people are addressing these big issues that in many ways I think are being ushered in by the crisis in which we find ourselves. And so I think that this crisis has the potential to really wake us up and get us beyond the nonsense of dualism and competing and and to face this crisis together and to bring whatever wisdom you have. If it's from your atheism, fine. If it's from your Buddhism or your Christianity or your Judaism, great. Whatever you bring to the table, bring it. But so I think that we're on the verge of something that's potentially very, very amazing. But everything is die. Everything has to die. All our institutions, I think, education is failing. Certainly religion is failing. But obviously politics is failing. Economics is failing. The media is failing. So if we can put front and center this primal value, which is the survival of the planet with all its marvelous creatures and the human included, this has the potential, I think, of saving us, whether we'll get around to it, whether we'll have the courage to let go and to start over and give birth to new forms of energy and everything else, that I think waits to be seen.
It certainly seems like our beliefs have taken us away from creation, in fact, and separated us into the left brain, and that this is, creation wins. I mean, either we come home again or terrible things are going to happen. How do we, you talked recently about waking up, you know, spirituality being about waking up. How do we bring ourselves awake and each other? Because our beliefs won't save us.
Well, I think there are two ways to wake up. One is love and beauty and a recovered sense of the sacred that people were all talking about. And the other is danger and extinction, the via positiva and the via negativa. Both of them stir the human heart. And I think that we are at this place of extremes, of crisis. And of course, as you know, the Chinese language talks about crisis and opportunity being the same thing. And, you know, I love what Aquinas says about being asleep, acedia, the lack of energy to begin new things, that the medicine for that is, as he says, zeal comes from intense experience of the beauty of things. So to fall in love again with the very things people were talking about, the deer in your backyard, the place where the waters and the soil come together, the old tree, the seasons, you know, to not take for granted. And when you're falling in love, you don't take for granted.
Yeah.
So to move from taking for granted and passivity, which in fact is what most of our economic system wants us to be passive consumers, to break out of that, to recover the throat chakra, our prophetic vocation, our capacity to say no, our capacity to speak out. And that includes electing representatives who are saying no to the dark forces that are in fact making a killing in the process of raping the earth and so forth. I think this, all of prophecies about waking up. The prophet's trying to wake people up, and we have to wake ourselves up. We have to be prophets to ourselves, as well as to one another. So, you know, again, I think that's and we have to look around for who are the leaders, dead and alive, that can continue to wake us up by their example. And I think of people like Dorothy Day. Mm-hmm. I think of people like Sister Dorothy Stang, and I mean, there are so many people. I've been working on my friend Thomas Aquinas, and I'm just continually stunned by so many of his observations and insights, and that have never been shared with people, because Thomists have done to Aquinas what a lot of Christians have done to Jesus. You know, that we reduce the into we commit reductionism on them we shrink them into something that will fit into our minds or our souls or our agendas, usually it's our agendas, and we just totally distort the prophets that we've been given over the centuries, our ancestors. So, you know, they have a right to be liberated from their cage and shout to us today.
Gail, you want to pick up from here? We're trading off to Gail Ransom for part two of this interview, which is about the sacred. Gail, where are you?
She's muted.
I'm muted.
There you are.
Now she's unmuted.
Also, Matt, we're interested in what you experience as sacred and what does that experience feel like? Just so we can recognize it ourselves too and perhaps feel confident about things we didn't recognize in ourselves. What is sacred and how can you tell it's sacred? What moves in you?
Well, I liked all the examples that people came up with. I think the sacred is that which is bigger than ourselves, that which makes us, rather than just what we make, although we can also contribute as co-creators and bring more of the sacred into history, into the world. But it's that which preceded us. And when you think about it, especially given the new cosmology, every being is that way. That there is a 13.8 billion year history to every being we encounter. And if you keep that in mind, that's your way of seeing the world, then each being we encounter is a story in itself and has something to teach us for sure. One of my favorite definitions of the sacred comes from Bob Gostorce, a Lakota teacher, who said, if you want to know how sacred water is, go without it for 3 days. So I think that, again, under the climate extinction emergency that we're in, we're facing the disappearance, the extinction of so many species, and water is part of it. I mean, California went through a 7-year drought, and I think a lot of people learn how we can take water for granted and that it is sacred. So, but there's a methodology in that statement by Buck Gostorce that you learn the sacred by fasting. That's kind of the voluntary way of learning. Or you can learn the sacred by having things ripped away from you. That's more involuntary, you might say. But the sacred is that without which we can't be. But the sacred is being itself. And so I think that meditating on the empty chair, which I like to tell people to do, and to put in the empty chair all your brothers and sisters that were never born and never will be born, I think that's an important practice to learn the sacred, because then you learn that your existence and that of brothers and sisters, if you have them, is quite a miracle in the universe. It's a marvel. It's a surprise. And you can't really explain it. And so I see that the sacred is, when you kind of bring it down to the ground, it's existence itself. And of course, as Eckhart's saying, isness is God. That's the ultimate sacred, is to have existence. And then from that, different beings have their own personalities, their own jobs to do, and their own histories. But it's all sacred. So it's a way of seeing the world. And it's the same as Jesus saying, the kingdom and queen of God is here. It's already among you, but we're not seeing it very well. Our vision needs some cleansing. And it's that opening poem from Mary Oliver, that we meditated on. That every being is revealing the divine.
Thank you. In your meditations, can
hello?
I think she's.
Yes?
Well, there you are.
We lost you.
Sorry. So Matthew, in your meditations, you've encouraged us to spend some time every day meditating, appreciating, feeling gratitude, and also to some kind of prophetic action, and also to be creative every day. And I think there's a groundswell, obviously, of appreciation of what you're asking of us, and some other, you know, brothers and sisters that you have are doing this work that you're doing. So there seems to be like this groundswell of people who are ready to take the next step. And some of us are making some of our last steps now. We aren't, we aren't 14 anymore. So we need to be really, really serious and strategic about how we spend our time and what we do each day. I wondered if you would advise us on what you think, in some way that we could all step forward together into the new age.
Well, I love what CSC did a couple summers ago in creating a ritual for a rite of passage for the elders. Because I think that's not only really important for elders, it's important for the culture, it's important for young people. Of course, young people also deserve rites of passage, and we're doing a lousy job with them. I think that confirmation is pretty thin rite of passage for most people today, if they undergo it at all. But I think that elders recovering the realization, contrary to what our culture teaches, that there's an important role for elders. And I think the primary role of elders is to link up with younger people and to encourage them, to support them, to listen to them, and encourage their responsibility. And also, eventually, to share our own stories and wisdom. But I think this is organic. I think it's built into the grandparent and grandchild relationship. And I think our culture has done a horrible job of honoring that relationship. And I think it has a lot to do, frankly, with the demise of the planet. And I love this scientific study that was done a couple years ago by a woman anthropologist with a team. And she set out to discover why is it that our Neanderthal ancestors died out and the Homo sapiens, we survived. And of course, until she went on her mission to answer that question, the dominant theory was that the we Homo sapiens went to war with all the Neanderthals and beat them all up. And that's why they disappeared. But of course, one thing they found is that a lot of us are carrying Neanderthal DNA in us. So we weren't just making war with the Neanderthals. But what she found is this, that your average Neanderthal died around the age of 41 or so. In other words, they had no grandparents. They had no elders. And whereas our species, the average age was something like 53 or something, or 55. So that there were three generations of out. So I just think that scientific fact is so important. because it shows that being an elder, you know, is not about being patronized because you got white hair or because you're still hanging around. It's a necessity. Our species has survived because we've had three generations, not two, at a time. And elders have to hear this, that we're needed. And I think this is why every human indigenous tribe I've ever heard of honors the elders. I don't think, again, it's not about patronizing the old people. It's about their memory. They remember that it's because of the elders that the tribe has survived. And I think we have to recover that today in spades. And I think get that word out. And of course, speaking of words, throw out the word retirement, which I think is the most obscene word in our language, and replace it with refirement and rewirement, which is what happens as you get older. You get rewired, we get more mystical as we get older. And that's more the right brain moves in, because we all know we're leaving, consciously or unconsciously, and what really counts comes to the fore, and that means beauty counts. And older people get much more attuned to beauty, just like we were as children. And that's the rewirement that happens. I think our right brains, if you want to put it that way, become much more alive. So that's what I would urge, that we shake up this whole eldership thing and really make some noise about it. Because, and for one thing, our generation and the boomer generation, which is younger than me, I guess, a lot of older people are healthy today. They got time in their hands and they want to do something worthwhile. Well, I think this is where it starts. I think shaking up the illusion in which our culture lives, that the older ones don't have anything to offer, shaking that up and kicking some butt is a really important part of our survival as a species today.
Thank you. Penny, I would you continue with, thank you, Matt.
I'd love to. I had the great privilege of hearing what was titled The Future of Religion, Spirituality, and Earth. A bold title for a bold talk the other month. And I pulled and have been chewing on a lot of what was said, and I would love you to expound a bit about Einstein's third stage of religion.
Mm-hmm.
And perhaps link it to what you also said about the need for the right brain today.
Mm-hmm. Sure. Well, Einstein said we're entering a third era of religion. And if you want, I can get the exact quote. Give me 1 second. Right here. I reproduced this in my book on the Stations of the Cosmic Christ that I did with Bishop Mark Andrus. But I love the quote. And it blew my mind because I'd never seen it anyplace. It's not well known. I found it book done by a friend of Einstein's, and blows my mind, and I hope some other people too, because of course Einstein was responding to the Holocaust. He was pretty pissed off, can't imagine why, by the churches in Germany that did not take on Hitler nearly as courageously as they should have. And here's how he puts it. We are now moving into the third phase of religious experience, cosmic religion. With his growing knowledge of the vastness of the universe and its trillions of stars, each one many times larger than our planet, stars whose light takes hundreds of years to reach our eyes, humans must consider it an insult when we are told that our conduct should be motivated by fear of punishment or hope of reward. It is just as much an insult to the God who created all these marvels to be lowered to a human level. The true religious genius has always been endowed with a sense of cosmic religion. This oneness of creation, to my sense, is God. So that's Einstein's definition of God, the oneness of creation. This concept of God will unite all nations. A new age of peace will be inaugurated when all people profess a cosmic religion, when the youth have become laymen with scientific minds. I think it's so interesting, too, that he brings the youth in there, because that's what I was talking about with my last question, elders and the youth coming together. So an elder like Einstein is telling the youth, hey, religion is a healthy religion is going to be cosmic. And of course, Walt Whitman wrote about this 150 years ago. But that's how poets and mystics often are. They're about 150 years ahead of everybody else. So anyway, and of course, the new cosmology that a lot of us are exposed to, Barry and Brian Sprimino, that's part of this too, for sure. But I think I talk about it as the marriage of psyche and cosmos that was rent. It was torn asunder in the modern age. And the year I put on that is year 1600, the year that the Catholic Church burned Giordano Bruno at the stake. Why did they burn Giordano Bruno at the stake in 1600? Because he was trying to bring Copernicus's view of the cosmos into religion. And I think with that act of violence and sadism, they also tortured him before they burned him. They cut his tongue out, among other things. I think that science wanted a truce with religion, and science said, we're going to take the universe. Why don't you believers take the soul? And I think some believers were set up for that by Augustine's dualism and anthropocentrism and the rest. And so science went out and discovered the powers of the universe and all, and a lot of truths about it. And religion became more and more introspective and silly and confessing sins, 99% of which were sexual. And so it's just been a pathological situation, I think, that we've had science without conscience in great part, often, selling its soul to the military, selling its soul to chemical companies, selling its soul to empire builders and the rest. And then we've had religion without creation, without the cosmos, which is a pathology for sure. And certainly an insult to Jesus or any other spiritual genius, because as Einstein said, every spiritual genius has had a cosmic understanding of the presence of the divine, of the sacred. And it's not about, you know, little insy-bincy human beings being saved from their fear of going to hell. I mean, I really like how Einstein nails that. If your religion is based on either fear of hell or reward in heaven, you're barking up the wrong tree. That's not what religion's about. So, I like that passage from Einstein. And I think it's a wake-up call. And, you know, he wasn't a stupid guy. And I love that word marvel that he uses, because it's so Jewish. And that comes up in this wonderful book where I got that passage. He's in that book, he's in each chapter, he's with two people, this friend of his, and then his friend brought someone in to visit him. One person was a young physicist who had attempted suicide. But in one of these chapters, he brought in a fundamentalist with him who spent the whole time, 2 hours, trying to convert Einstein to his Lord and Savior, Jesus Christ. And it's amazing being a fly in the wall for that encounter. But things come out of Einstein you've never heard before. And one of them was this guy who was trying to convert him said, well, the problem with you, Einstein, is that you don't believe in miracles. And I just said, I beg your pardon. He said, I marvel every day when I'm reading Euclid and reading Leibniz. And he goes on and says, so immediately, this is a Jewish understanding of miracle, marvel. And that's the real etymological word of miracle too, a marvel. Things to wonder at, wondrous things. And the whole idea that miracle is somehow a lightning bolt that interferes with the laws of nature, that's typical modern thinking, because if you think you're living in a machine and all that, then you're fighting the machine. The miracle is fighting the machine. But the much more primal, foundational meaning of miracle is what we were talking about earlier, the miracle of isness, the miracle of existence, and then all the beauty that goes with it, all the diversity of it, the marvel of creation. So I think that's the medicine that we being invited into today, is a cosmic awareness, but not just the whole, the macrocosm, but also the microcosm, that every being has its history, and it's a cosmic history. We all, you know, run the movie of the universe backwards 14.8 billion years, 13.8 billion years, and you come to this one point. So it's all been marvelous. The whole trip has been a marvel. And what a pity for humans to miss out on that in our, whatever it is, 70, 75, 85 years of existence as individuals, to be caught up in fear or idolatry, which is what I think a lot of our capitalist system has bequeathed us. What a pity to miss the marvel of our existence.
Thank you. We touched on this in Racine, and I thought, as I honed in on my actual question, because you were also talking about Naming the Unnameable, one of your latest books. What is your imagining of a God for the Great Turning?
Huh. Well, a panentheistic understanding of the divine. There's a line that just hit me this morning in Aquinas, of all things, about he calls God the unfathomable ocean of being, the unfathomable ocean of being. So that we're all in the divine already. And Jesus is saying that when he talks about the kingdom and queendom of God. So I think any God today has to be panentheistic, has to be both within and we within it. And I think the divine has to have this balance of the masculine and the feminine, and the light and the dark. I think Taoism does a real good job of kind of offering us an image where you have the Taoist symbol where it's round. And I think that's important too, the roundedness, which is maternal also. Like Hildegard said, we are encircled by the arms of the mystery of God. That, again, we have to go beyond the vertical. But that's not to say to destroy transcendence. One of the points I was making this morning is that for Aquinas, the transcendence is not up, it's not beyond, it's not God out there. But what makes God so transcendent is that divinity is so much bigger than our minds are capable of. That's why he says that the greatest accomplishment of the human mind, even though he was a devourer of knowledge, the greatest accomplishment of the human mind is to know that we cannot know God. And so the apophatic divinity, the God without a name, who will never be given a name, like Eckhart talks about it, this has to come forward today in a very prominent way. For one thing, it teaches us humility, but theological, religious humility. And it allows the mystery of divinity, of what Aquinas calls the unknown divinity, to emerge. And so I think that on the one hand, again, it's both and. We want to find the sacred and the divine in all beings, but we also want to make room for the unknown divinity, the mystery, the silence that is God, and the nameless God, as Eckhart says, the God who has no name and will never be given a name. And it can't be given a name because it's so much greater than we can even imagine, and yet so much more present. And Aquinas says that too, that divinity is more within things than the things are within things. So divinity is radically within all being, as well as being the setting, the matrix, the mother holding all things, the ocean, the unfathomable ocean. So those are a few of the elements of divinity, and also that divinity is always, as Eckhart says, always in the beginning, it's always new. And the idea of newness and spirit for Eckhart go hand in hand, that spirit is always creating new things, that the new creation is happening. And I think that sense of newness is, and freshness is also, an important dimension of a divinity for our time. Yeah.
Would you say it's a God of hope? Because statistics are pretty troubling these days.
Well, I my favorite definition of hope is David Orr, the eco-philosopher, who says hope is a sleeve with the is a verb with the sleeves rolled up. For me, hope is proportionate. It's relative to our willingness to do our work, both inner work and outer work. It's not enough just to be doing outer work today, just go off and be a lawyer, go off and be a teacher, go off and be a therapist or a politician. No, in whatever field we're in, we have to do the inner work too. We have to go deeper in work. We can't absorb our culture's definition of work any more than we can absorb our culture's definition of elders or our culture's definition of masculinity or even femininity. I think we have to all get more proactive. We have to take responsibility for co-creating new wisdom, which may be very ancient wisdom, about what real masculinity is, about what real eldership is and growing old is about, and about what real hope is. And to me, hope is not just sitting around waiting for some optimism to hit you. Hope is doing something, but it is at work, it's sleeves rolled up. And so you create hope, especially where there's despair and where there's darkness. You create hope by finding allies and working and birthing new things together. In my daily meditations, I've been telling a story about this amazing woman in Nepal. She's from Germany, actually. In fact, we met her because she signed up to join our seminar in Italy this summer on Aquinas. But she's amazing. She's devoted, 25 years of her life in Nepal working with lepers, because in Nepal, lepers are treated like non-beings. And she's created this what she calls it a community or a family, even she calls it. And it's just amazing what they do. And she has these people, they're very, very poor. They're all street people. And of course, with serious physical limitations, but she has them making art out of the stuff from the streets, broken bottles and all the rest, very much like Lily Ye used to do. And I have some daily meditations on her in the inner city and in Philadelphia and so forth. But the point is that this is hope when you're doing something with those who have, you might say, who are have every right to be in despair, the people she's working with. So if she can work with people so much at the edge of survival and bring hope in their lives, and they do, she does, because then these people who she helps support and give a decent life to, a roof over their heads and the rest, then they become leaders for other lepers and so forth. So that's what hope means. Hope means, you know, passing the beauty around and passing the healing around. And so that's why I don't know a better definition of hope than David Orr, that hope is a verb with the sleeves rolled up.
Thank you. Gail?
You're muted. Voila.
So I'm on my daughter's Mac. So
in I know you. So. You told us that. We understand. Yeah. I understand.
I'm my granddaughter, though, really. So
that too.
So here's the time to ask some questions. Let's just take a second there to think all the things that Matt has talked about and touched on. And you might think we've left something out, or you want to ask a follow-up question. And I think the best way for me, it seems things are going pretty well here in the mute department when I don't touch it. So I think we don't have any, sometimes we have background noise, it makes it really bad. So I'm going to try to unmute all of us. So if you have a question, you could just raise your hand so people can see you if you are on camera. And then if not, just listen and ask some questions. So I'm going to give you a moment just to think. Okay, and I'm going to ask you, because I don't know this Mac well enough, to unmute yourself, and Mary Ann will start. Thank you, Mary Ann.
Yeah, I have no struggle for asking questions. And Matthew, you're going to come here to Calgary in January.
That's right.
Mm-hmm. So, yeah. Okay, well, and you guys are probably experts in this, given you've had years of this, but we've had decades of conservative government in Alberta, and Alberta, that's what it does. It votes conservative. So our latest premier, this is, you're going to love this. He took 10%. He's reducing 10% of funding for post-secondary education. Immediately, that affects lots and lots of people. And he pulled the curriculum from the public schools. They spent 2 years developing this curriculum, training. He pulled it out, and he hired someone from the US to advise on curriculum. That person actually is funded by the Koch brothers. How about that? This is no word of a lie. So, and the first thing he did, he's elected this year, the first thing he did before all of this stuff is he set aside $30 million, which is a lot of money for our province. We have basically 3 million people in it, to, as a war chest, to combat environmental propagandists. That this stuff's already out there, videos on Facebook about, So my question is, do we just carry on? Like, I guess, I mean, I don't know what else we can, but do you just carry on it so that at this level, the lowly people, you know, we just work, we just keep working, we just keep going, like, to fight, to get embroiled in fights seems useless. How can we ignore it, but how can we fight it? So carry on, is that
I'm not in favor. I never liked that state saying by the British, what is it? Keep calm and carry on. I can't stand that. So well, I'm not keeping calm, but all, carry on.
You have my empathy. I hope we have yours. It's all too familiar, this story you're saying. And the whole Koch brother thing, I've done some research on that, and it's scarier than people know. I mean, for example, they set up these over many, many years. I mean, it was, you have to give them credit for really planning and doing this at, like over a 30-year period or so. They had these workshops for lawyers and potential judges. And they, something like 75% of American judges went through their workshops. And of course, they were free or something. But the point is, I mean, they had a whole plan on how to kind of re-educate people's minds in their ideology. So, you know, anything's possible in those circumstances. But no, I agree with you. I don't think the answer is more serenity. I think the answer is moral outrage and how to organize it. I mean, that's what real politics is. You know, if serenity was being shouted in the 18th century, instead of throwing tea into the ocean and all this that went on, there never would have been an American Revolution. We'd all be speaking the Queen's English and all that, which of course you're doing in Canada. But and so that I think that's really what politics is. It's lassoing anger and moral outrage and steering it into positive, not outrageous action. And that's what Gandhi did. It's what King did. And so you have to tap into that anger and that passion. And people forget that the word passion is in compassion. And anger is part of passion. Aquinas is so good on that when he says that. In fact, he even says all virtues lie in the passion, not in the will, but in passion. And so it's about awakening passion, but organizing it and having some, giving it directions. So it's not just venting all over the walls. But, you know, when Gandhi organized the march to the sea, that was gathering the anger of the people, but they did something effective, and it was a statement, a prophetic metaphor for ridding the country of British colonialism. And of course, the same is true with King, with filling the jails and so forth. So now, but you do it kind of way things. Is this, you know, how, what is the gap between the Koch mentality and some sense of justice and eco justice in Calgary at this time? I don't know. I mean, you could look at some of the red states in America and say, well, you know, it's not worth the effort to carry on a fight there at this time. Better to carry on with this some possibility of one group, what you're going to say, enlightening another group and so forth. So I think you have to figure that out on your own, kind of, or in your, not on your own, but I mean in your place, because I don't know Calgary that well, but politically. I just say in ending that, no, I don't think the answer to injustice is more serenity. No, I don't. And Jesus didn't operate that way. I mean, it's stunning, really. He got himself killed at 30 years of age. And I think we need both the holy patience of a Buddha who lived to be 84 and died serenely, and the holy impatience of a Jesus who got himself killed at 30 for taking on the empire. And you have to find that, we have to find that rhythm and that dialectic in the choices that we make, which is, of course, as Aquinas says, what virtue is. It's about making choices. So one of the big questions then is, who are your allies? And you know, how can you get together and try to enlighten people? And remember, it may not happen in your lifetime, you know. But, and of course, how are you raising your children and your grandchildren? What values are coming to the fore? And can you get online and create your own blog or your own interaction or support those who are trying to raise consciousness and all this? So education has to happen, that's for sure. But a lot of it, I mean, I do think the eco crisis is going to come tumbling down on all these people who are in denial. I mean, they're going to be without water like everyone else, you know. And in fact, a lot of them are quite wealthy. You know, they can't hide in their towers with golden toilets 24 hours a day. And, you know, it's going to affect all of us, rich and poor.
Okay, I'll just say okay, I'm going to do what you say, like a draw closer to like other leaders, other allies, and I'm hoping, my thought is I'm going to have discussions I'm going to invite people to my house to do what Greta says, just listen to the scientists, no other agenda at all. How do I learn this? What do the scientists say to me? Mm-hmm. How do I understand them? How do you understand them? How do we understand them? That's it. Just to like, anyway, that's one of my thoughts, just as a personal, easy, maybe, I don't know if it'll be easy.
Well, one of the biggest questions too is our diets. I had a brilliant talk. I was on a program a month or two ago at the Sierra Club, and I was asked to speak on Laudate Si, the Pope's encyclical, and also the Order of the Sacred Earth. Then they had two scientists, and one of them, make long story short, he's from India, though he's worked in Silicon Valley for years, but he quit all that, made some money, and quit to work on the earth, salvation of the earth. And he said that we could stop climate change and send it back in 10 years by doing one thing, going vegan. And he had all the statistics. He's an engineer, and he said, I've done the work, and he put it up on the screen. He said, by going vegan and planting trees in all the areas that we now have livestock, that would be 1 trillion trees, and that's what will save the earth. 1 trillion trees will save the earth and reverse climate change. Now, you know, I was really amazed by that, and I think it's just really, really interesting. I'd never heard anyone say that we can stop and even reverse climate change. But he started out on a very positive note. He said, you know, our species prevented an ice age several thousand years ago because we tore down so many forests that we warmed the planet. Unfortunately, now, he said, we've brought in a fire age because we're doing the same thing. So all we have to do is reverse ourselves. And the key is the amount of land that we're turning over to raising livestock. And if we could stop doing that, that would make all the difference. So, you know, I know a lot of people, especially young people, who are very deliberately vegan. And, you know, to get the word out more about our diets. Now, even if you're not vegan, you could be vegetarian, or you could eat less meat. So, you know, there are kind of degrees of this, although his statistics work around being vegan. But the point is, all of us can raise consciousness about our diets and eat less meat or no meat and start beating the drums to plant trees and start planting trees. It's interesting, this group of lepers in Nepal who are utterly poor and utterly physically handicapped, they are also planting trees. They were marching. She has pictures of them marching on Climate Day a few weeks ago. You know, people who can barely walk, they are marching and so forth too. So, I mean, you know, the education you can do is beyond just the province of Calgary, that we could be spreading this word of diet, and that alone could change everything. Especially the younger generation. I think when you're young, it's easier to go on a vegan diet because as you get older, your body has so many problems and habits that aren't necessarily real healthy.
Thank you. We have a minute for some other question. Does someone else have a question to pose? Remember to unmute yourself. Mm-hmm. I think we can move on. John, are you next then, since we're so quiet here?
I'm gonna ask one question and wonder if this is all a process of our own humanity's spiritual evolution. Are we waking up in such a way that we really are going to change our nature, even though it's a long struggle?
I hope it is. I think it's possible. I don't think we'll survive without a transformation of our species happening, and rapidly, very rapidly, in the lifetimes of people on the planet now. I think that our survival depends. And of course, to me, this is not different from Jesus talking about metanoia, a change of consciousness. Mm-hmm. And so I think that it's kind of a question, you know, takes us back to the original discussion, your original question, you know, that is this happening, this apocalyptic happening, a word that you use, is this a wake-up call to bring our species to its next level of evolution? And in which we absolutely need in order to survive. So it's not kind of a pleasantry, it's a survival reality. But I do think it also brings us to the deepest teachings of the spiritual avatars of the world. And by that I mean compassion and justice and, you know, caring for others and those not yet born for the future. So it's not as if we would be thrust into a whole new world. We would be thrust into the world, I think, that Jesus was trying to talk about, that Isaiah was trying to talk about, that the Buddha was trying to talk about, Muhammad was talking about. I think that, you know, that's on the agenda, and that's why I do think, this is a spiritual moment. And it's also about creativity, isn't it? About the explosion of our, if it's true that what I said earlier, that everything is collapsing. And I think that is pretty obvious. I don't know one profession that has its dignity intact. Yeah. I mean, one thing, you know, I can't believe these lawyers who are making up these stories for Trump, for example, about how he can never be investigated, he can never do anything wrong. I mean, it's so crazy. I've lost all respect for the legal profession, that they can get away with that and not be dumped from the legal profession. But I mean, I lost most respect for the legal profession a long time ago when I checked out the Supreme Court. But anyway, you know, all the professions are in complete collapse. And so I just think, it's a tremendous moment for the spirit. You know, my mentor, Per Chenu, he was interviewed in his 90s by a French journalist, he's French, who interviewed theologians around the country, but most of them were in their 40s or 50s. And he said after his interview with Chenu was the youngest theologian he interviewed, and he was like 92. And one thing he asked Chenu, now this was way back, I don't know, in the 80s or so, he said, what about what's happening in the church? Isn't it all collapsing and everything? And Chenu said, isn't that wonderful? He said, you can't have an omelet without breaking the eggs. He said, this is when the Holy Spirit goes to work, and when everything is collapsing. And I think that's how we have to look at it too, that there has to be a tremendous Pentecost, a tremendous awakening of the spirit, including the spirit of creativity and transformation, and that can work through science as well as through any other field, including art. I mean, all our efforts at work, our professions, can be awakened, I think, in this circumstance of what you call apocalypse. Remember, the word apocalypse also means revelation. And so what it comes down into is this, that the moment has come to reveal who we really are as a species. Are we just greedy? Are we just the reptilian brain? Are we just win-lose? Are we just empire builders who you know, my team wins and your team loses? Is that who we are? Is that the revelation? Or are we something much deeper than that? And that's where I think Jesus and the Buddha and other prophets come in to tell us, hey, the potential is there to be compassionate like God is. So, you know, give that a try for a change.
Coming forth into the world with the oldest and newest consciousness.
That's right. That's right. And it will be like a new wineskin because there's been so little of it. but we do have these examples. I mean, you can't look at this woman in Nepal and not be moved by her generosity and her courage and her strength. And there's so many people like that around the world doing wonderful things. Of course, they don't make the news, but those are all examples of what the future of our species can be.
She sees the world without filters that make it into something else. She sees it as it is.
That's right. And what it can be.
What it can be. Well, should we work toward closing, Gail?
I think so. We did have your birthday's coming up, Matthew, so we had something to say about that.
Well, segueing on the whole discussion of planting more trees, which was very apt that it would come up at
Thank
this point,
so
we
much.
Close with our great thanks to Matt for being here, and we want to honor him with a birthday gift because he's turning 79 next month. And in line with his commitment to creation and our commitment, we are asking for donations to be sent to Creation Spirituality Communities and earmarked for Creation in Crisis. And our plan is to purchase 250 trees in his name, planted around the world. They're at a cost of $1 a tree. And this number, though it may seem strange, Gail tells me, is based on a very careful calculus. It's 79 years of life, 118 books authored, introduced, or forwarded, and 53 years of ministry. So, donate what you can, and with great gratitude and appreciation, we are planting trees in your name.
Oh, I moved. Thank you very much. Thank you. That's a beautiful, beautiful gift. I appreciate it.
For the participants our guests, I'll send you the link, and I had your email address.
Oh, sound.
So I'll send that to you that way, so you can just kind of click and add to it, add to our gift.
Is Penny closing, or how are we closing?
Penny is closing.
I can. This is a beautiful book called The Fire of Darkness by poet Alfred K. Lamott. And it's based on responding to drawings and art from Roshani Rea. And this is a poem that we've been using quite a bit in our Great Turning Gatherings of Joanna Macy. And I offer it for a closing now. Thank you, Matt, for showing up and being part of our discussion today.
Thank you for inviting me. Thanks for everyone for coming.
Great inspiration, Matt. Thank you so much for giving us wisdom and energy to move forward. I appreciate it. Anyone else?
Thank you for allowing me, like, as a guest. You know, I've never come to one of these before. I really appreciate it.
Good.
Glad to have you. Yeah.
I like being in your study, too.
No.
Yeah. It looks a lot like those books.
What's that? Looks like what?
It looks like John's study, very much.
Oh, really? Oh.
Yeah, he's in front of bricks for some reason.
Well, I had to change computers to survive.
It's all about deep adaptation now.
There it is.
Right. Thank you.
All right. I'll close with this. Our mother, who art in Gaia, brown as loam, nameless as rain, may your presence be a golden void, the absence of the search. Let your family dwell here as a circle, not a kingdom, where spirit and body, heaven and earth, mingle in small sacraments of compost and compassion. Be the breath we take, the bread we make each day with our own wrinkled hands. Let our prayer word be enough. For you are the weaver of galaxies into nests for young planets. And you sing the whole sky in a robin's egg. In you, we are always home. Dissolve the veil of judgment. Dispel our illusion of impurity, so that we may immerse one another in your bodily fluids of abounding goodness. For thine is the roundness and the brokenness and the healing. Amen.
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 Very nice.
Thank you.
Thank you all. This is sponsored by Creation Spirituality Communities, and we're grateful for their support. Thank you, Matt, so much for coming.
You bet. Thanks for the invite. Bye.
Join us again sometime.
Bye-bye. Keep up the good work.
Blessings.
Okay. John, are you there? There he is still.
Are we debriefing or?
I'm hoping we will.
But I think John might have left us.
Oh, maybe he had to take care of his wife.
All right.
I'll text him and see if he's going to do it.
Oh, Penny Moulis in the yellow haze.
Is that Penny? Penny! Ah, Penny! I've been muted. Penny, I have been sending you emails. Penny? Oh, she disappeared.
Oh.
I was hoping she could help us with the tech side. She said she's good at that.
Okay. Well.
There's somebody up here. Who's up here? Thomas. Okay. So.
Shall we just plan to do it another time?
I guess so. Okay.
All right.
All right. Goodbye, everybody. Anything? Pardon?
Did I miss anything? I was making dinner. Sorry.
What, did you listen?
Yeah, I did.
Okay.
I didn't learn anything too much new.
Yeah, but it's so generous to just talk through that stuff again for us. It's like you have to hear it again. And but I got new stirrings in my heart and a sense of possibilities this time. I hope you did. Got something like that too.
I did, yeah. Because of all of you. It takes all of us, so
yeah.
It's sad though.
You're sad?
No, it is sad.
Our situation?
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
There's a website called Good Grief, Good Grief Net, I think it is. Very good material on. In fact, here it is. Let's see. Goodgrief.org. And she's got some wonderful material. You know, we have to deal with the difficult emotions around the unthinkable. And
you do. I kind of lift that.
Yeah. And the other thing I wrote over on the side here is that Jim Bendel was speaking, and he's another great one. Do you know his work?
I do not.
Okay, he's a fellow who's talking on deep adaptation, and putting really important stuff together. And in the midst of all of his writing and talking is the fact that we are grieving as we do everything we do. So that's another one I would point you to. And he spoke it with Buddhists, and he said, this is a time when we need equanimity. You know, it's not a time for serenity. It's not a time for bliss, but we need that to stay balanced so we don't burn out and we can maintain our ability to be effective. And I think that's a helpful one for me to chew on, because it's so easy to go to extremes in emotion. So,
all right, guys, thank you. And it was wonderful. It always is. It's always a blessing to hear and to see everybody. So
I'm glad you joined us, Tom. It's nice to see you again.
Yeah. Good to see you.
We've had some other good days.
Next month.
We've got a nice
Taco
mix in the refrigerator, or in the baking in the oven as we speak. So
fabulous. Well, I'm coming to your house.
Yeah.
Where's your house?
Michigan.
Okay.
All right.
Okay.
All right, Gail.
Okay, Penny.
Enjoy Florida.
Oh, thank you. I will.
Which part do you go to?
We go to Anna Maria Island.
Oh.
And then, well, this is all, you know, friends have places that they give us. So then we go into Marco Island. It's a condo, and it's like the 20th floor, and it's a quarter, you know, so you could sit, and there's balconies. I mean, you know, it costs a lot of money. There's balconies on two sides because it's on the corner. And you can look out there, and you only see a wildlife refuge island and the ocean. It's just like you're on this big congested island, but you can't see it.
Oh,
I just sit there. I just sit there with my mouth open. I just go.
That okay? Let the mystic out.
Yeah.
All right. See you next month.
Okay. See you next month. Bye. Mm-hmm.